Hi there. My name is Sevag Demirjian. This presentation is part of an educational series about kidney medicine and extracorporeal support. Enjoy. Today, we will review ECMO from nephrology perspective. Laminar flow rate of blood along a tube is proportional to the fourth power of the radius. It also depends on blood viscosity, pipe length, and pressure difference. This, of course, is summarized by Poiseuille's law. If we rearrange the formula to solve for pressure, it will be easier to understand when there is a narrowing or a kink in a cannula, there will be an exponential rise in pressure. ECMO can be deployed in two primary ways: veno-arterial, similar to cardiopulmonary bypass, or veno-venous, used in the setting of isolated respiratory failure. Basic ECMO configuration consists of a pump, membrane oxygenator, tubing, vascular access, cannulae. The oxygenator is connected to a source of fresh gas flow via an air-oxygen blender and heat exchanger. In the ECMO circuit, pressures are negative pre-pump and positive post-pump. ECMO drain pressure can get affected, as we reviewed earlier, by higher flow rates or change in tube diameter due to clot or kink. Chronically, this will manifest as chugging or suck down due to sudden rise in negative pressure. Return pressure, again, will be higher with high blood flow relative to the tube size or if there is a kink or flow impediment. Another clinically important parameter is the pressure drop across the oxygenator, which could be due to high viscosity or clotting. Let's take a closer look at the oxygenator. This is where gas exchange occurs. We oxygenate venous blood and remove carbon dioxide. Unlike what we've seen in a dialysis filter, here in the oxygenator, the blood flows around the hollow fibers, which either contain air for exchange or water for temperature control. The blender determines the air-oxygen mix, FiO2, and the airflow rate called sweep. Sweep gas flow is analogous to minute ventilation or dialysate flow rate. Next, let's talk about pumps. We talked about roller pumps previously, which are used with lower flow systems such as dialysis machines. Most modern ECMO circuits, however, use centrifugal pumps. Another innovation usually seen in these pumps is the magnetic coupling for non-contact transfer of torque, which will keep the blood sealed and less prone to blood leaks around the shaft. In comparison, roller pumps are a type of positive displacement peristaltic pumps. The rotor has a number of rollers, two in this case, which presses the tube as they rotate by. The part of the tube which is compressed is closed, forcing a constant amount of blood to move through the tube. Importantly, as the tube bounces open after the roller passes, blood is drawn into the tube from access. That's how you get your negative pressure. When we compare roller to centrifugal pumps, they are cheaper, need less blood for priming. They are also constant volume pumps, which means they maintain constant speed and flow regardless of afterload pressure. Whereas centrifugal pumps are afterload dependent, which is safer in situations where there is a sudden rise in pressure, which then leads to decrease in flow and avoid a catastrophic event such as dissection or cannula disconnection. Unlike bypass machines, ECMO circuits do not have venous reservoirs, which results in an increased risk for air emboli. Therefore, it's very important to take precautions during the process of hooking up the dialysis machine to the ECMO circuit. You may want to reduce ECMO flow for a short time to minimize negative pressure in the venous cannula and help minimize the risk for air emboli during dialysis machine connection to the circuit. Also, dialysis machine settings need to be adjusted so pressure alarms due to ECMO circuit hemodynamics are suppressed on the dialysis machine. There is significant variation in practice as to where the access and return lines of the dialysis machines are placed on the ECMO circuit. Most, however, place the return line from dialysis on the drain cannula, whereas the access line for dialysis can vary. It's important, however, to have a team approach when devising your own protocol, which should include your nephrologist, ECMO or perfusionist, intensivist, and surgical team.
Hope you enjoyed the presentation.